ابن عباس قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم نعمتان مغبون فيهما كثير من الناس الصحة والفراغ. الحديث رواه البخاري. نعم الله كثيرة وكثيرة جدا، وأكثر هذه النعم التي أكرمنا الله بها لم نؤدها حقها ولم نعرف قدرها وللأسف الشديد. الله تعالى يقول وما بكم من نعمة فمن الله، ويقول سبحانه وإن تعدوا نعمة الله لا تحصوها. فمن هذه النعم التي انخدع بها الكثيرون وخسر بسببها الأكثرون نعمة الصحة والفراغ. والغبن مغبون، والغبن هو هي كلمة لها عدة معان لكن تدور على الخداع والنقصان والخسارة وما أشبه ذلك، بمعنى أن هاتين النعمتين انخدع بهما الكثيرون فإذا بهم يفاجئون بنقيضها. كم من الناس انخدع بصحته فإذا هو مريض، فإذا هو ميت. كم من الناس انخدع بفراغه إذا بالشغل يأتيه من كل جهة ينشغل به عن أولى الأولويات وأول المقدمات كثيره. لكن المسلم الحق والذي يضبط نفسه ويستغل وقته ويعرف كيف يستغل أيضا ويستفيد من صحته في كل ما يقربه إلى الله ويبعده عن معصية الله سبحانه وتعالى. وفي هذا الحديث رد على من يقول الواجبات أكثر من الأوقات، هذه كلمة خطأ. الله تعالى يقول لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها، فكيف تكون الواجبات أكثر من الأوقات؟ والله عز وجل هو الذي أمر بهذه الواجبات وهو الذي شرع هذه الواجبات لتوافق هذه الأوقات. اليوم الليلة منها نوم ومنها راحة ومنها مداعبة للأولاد والأهل ومنها شغل في الدنيا ومنها عبادة ومنها سمر وسهر. إذن الأوقات كثيرة، لكن نحن نضيق على أنفسنا ونحن نغبن في هذه الأوقات فإذا بها تذهب من بين أيدينا سدى، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله.
This is a hadith from Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, who said that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said that there are two favors that many of the people are losers regarding them. These are the two favors of being healthy and having free time. The Sheikh said that the favors and the bounties of Allah upon us are many, and we did not fulfill the due right of these favors, the due right of thanks for these favors, and we did not know the value of these favors upon that Allah bestowed upon us. Allah says that whatever bounties you have, they are from Allah. And He also says, and were you to count the favors of Allah, you will not be able to list them or enumerate them. The Sheikh said that from these favors are the favors of being healthy and also having free time. The word maghbun here, the two favors, the word ghubn here that is mentioned in the hadith, the word maghbun, the root of it is ghubn. This word ghubn revolves around, it has different meanings, but it revolves around being deceived, being diminished, losing, being in a state of loss. This is the root meaning of that word, or the word, the meaning of it revolves around these meanings. So the meaning then of this hadith is that these two favors, a lot of people are deceived regarding them. They, because they are deceived, they get shocked when the opposite happens. So how many people, the Sheikh said, they are deceived by the health that they have, and then suddenly they get sick. They even after a while, they die. Other people, they are also deceived by the free time that they have. Then all of a sudden, they become so overwhelmingly busy, they don't have time for anything. But the true Muslim, he is someone who knows how to utilize, how to make use of his time, and he will benefit from the time when he is healthy and the time when he has free time. He will use these in things that will bring him closer to Allah Azza wa Jalla. The Shaykh said that in this hadith there is a refutation. It refutes those who say that the obligations are more than the times that we have. The obligations are more than the times. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who legislated these obligations. And he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah does not burden a soul more than it can bear. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the one who legislated these obligations. Now during the day you have time for rest. You have time to play with your children. You have time that to work. There is a time where you spend night time speaking to your visitors or your family, and the likes of that. The times are different and many, but we are the ones who make things narrowed down, you know, to ourselves, and we are the ones who become losers regarding these times that we are granted. So these times basically will go wastefully, not being used in something that is beneficial.
قال فكيف يشتغل بالدنيا من لا فراغ عنده؟ والمقصود بالفراغ هو الوقت هنا طبعا هو الوقت الخالي من أي عمل. كثير من الناس يكون عندهم وقت فارغ لا يستخدمونه لأي شيء، لا لنفع أنفسهم ولا لنفع غيرهم. وكان الإمام ابن الجوزي يستغل وقت زيارة بعض الفارغين عنده فيحضر لهم الأقلام ليبروها له، يشغلهم حتى لا يشغلهم، إذا لم يشغلهم بشيء سيشغلونه، هو رجل عالم. فكان يحضر لهم الأقلام إذا جاءوا يعني يريدون أن يضيعوا الوقت، فيقول له هذه الأقلام فبروها. لذلك قال من قال أهل العلم: والوقت أنفس ما عنيت بحفظه وأراه أسهل ما علي يضيع. الوقت أنفاس تتردد. الآن عندما تتنفس، هل النفس الذي يخرج يعود أم يخرج بلا عودة؟ هذه ثانية ذهبت من وقتك، صارت ضمت إليها أخرى وأخرى، صارت دقيقة فأخرى فأخرى، صارت ساعة أخرى فأخرى، صارت يوما وهكذا. فالأوقات إذا خرجت لا تعود، وإذا مضت لا ترجع. لذلك قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام: اغتنم خمسا قبل خمس، شبابك قبل هرمك، وصحتك قبل سقمك، وفراغك قبل شغلك، وغناك قبل فقرك، وحياتك قبل موتك. وهذه الخمس كلها أيضا مردها إلى الوقت، ومرجعها إلى الوقت وإلى الفراغ الذي يغبن فيه كثير من الناس. قال: وكيف يعرف الفراغ من كان وقته مليئا مليئا مليئا؟ إما بإراحة نفسه، هذا عمل، أن تريح نفسك عمل، كما قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام: إن لبدنك عليك حقا. وأن تطلب العلم، هذا أيضا وقت يجب أن يوضع في مكانه، وأن تملأ به فراغا، كذلك العبادة، كذلك الأهل والولد، كذلك العمل للدنيا، كذلك الزيارات والصداقات. لو نظرت ستجد أن الأوقات كلها ولله الحمد ممتلئة بالطاعة، حتى وأنت نائم في طاعة، لأنك في نومك تتقوى على الطاعة. من لم يأخذ راحته في نهاره هل يستطيع أن يقيم الليل؟ هل يستطيع أن يستيقظ على صلاة الفجر؟ هل يستطيع أن يؤدي الحقوق التي أناطها الله في عنقه؟ إذن يكون شيء بمقابل شيء، لا أن يكون شيء على حساب شيء آخر. نعم.
The Sheikh said, how is it that the one who doesn't have free time would busy himself with the worldly affairs? By the word faragh here, I mean the time that is empty, devoid of any action or deed. Many people, they have this type of a time. It's a time that is not used. They are free. They have free time, but they don't utilize it in something that is beneficial. The Sheikh mentioned that Al-Ibam ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah, he used to, sometimes when those people who have nothing to do, they just come to him and spend the time there, they don't have anything to do. He prepares the pencils for them, that when they come, they will sharpen those pencils, right? So, they come there, they have nothing to do, so they get busy sharpening the pencils. This sharpening tool is not the one that we have now. Some of them are electronic. These are the sharpeners, the old ones, that there is difficulty in using them. So basically he would do that while they are there. Then he mentioned a line of poetry from another scholar who said that the time is the most precious thing that I am careful to preserve or to guard, and I view it to be the easiest amongst the things to be wasted, the easiest to be wasted. It is the most precious to be guarded, yet it is the easiest to be wasted. The Sheikh said, for instance, you breathe now and you inhale, you exhale. When this exhale comes out, does it come back to you or not? The Sheikh said, it does not come back. So this is 1 second when you exhale. Then another second, they become a minute, another minute, another minute, it becomes an hour, and then more and more time. Those times when they go, when they elapse, then they don't come back. And this is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised the Muslims to seize the opportunity of 5 things before 5 things happen. You should seize the opportunity of your youthful time before you become old in age. You should seek opportunity or seize the opportunity of the time when you are healthy before the time comes when you become sick. You should seize the opportunity when you have free time before a time comes when you become very busy. And you should seize the opportunity of the time when you are wealthy before the time comes when you are poor. And you should seize the opportunity of you being alive before you become of the dead people. If you look at these 5 that Rasulullah ﷺ mentioned in this hadith, you will find that all of them can be referred to basically to the time and having free time, which many of us will waste. The Sheikh went on to say, and how is it that the Muslim whose time is completely full, how is it that he will have or will know that he has free time? The Sheikh said that there are many things that the Muslim can do during his time. He can seek knowledge, he can worship Allah Azza wa Jal, spend the time with the family and the children, he has to work to earn a living, he will be visiting other Muslims and visiting friends. So if you look at these many times, you will find that you can fill these times with obediences. Even when you go to sleep. Even when you go to sleep, this is because you are seeking by you going to sleep, you seek to strengthen yourself to be able to obey Allah Azza wa Jal. Otherwise, if you do not go to sleep, will you be able to pray night prayers, for instance, or when you wake up for Salat al-Fajr, you wouldn't be able to. So even when you go to sleep, this is something that you use to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. So all of the time of the Muslim is full. He doesn't really have free time.
وتذكرت قصة ذكرت في ترجمة أحد علماء دمشق وهو العلامة الشيخ جمال الدين القاسم قال كنت أمر في شوارع دمشق فأرى على مقاهيها بعض الناس يلعبون النرد فكنت أقول في نفسي والله لو أن الأوقات تباع وتشترى لاشتريت أوقات هؤلاء جميعا هؤلاء ليسوا فقط مغبونين في الفراغ بل هم آثمون فيه النرد يقول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام من لعب بالنردشير فكأنما صبغ يده في دم الخنزير انظروا إلى هذه الصورة وما تحمله من تنفير ففوق إضاعة الوقت يا ليت لو أنهم أضاعوا أوقاتهم فقط هكذا في الجلوس أو في البطالة لا هم يضيعون أوقاتهم في الحرام وفي مخالفة أمر الله عز وجل قال انظر رحمك الله ما قاله بعض العلماء عن بعض الأئمة عالم يكتب قصة عالم وما عايشه معه وما رآه منه قال جاورته في المدرسة مدرسة من مدارس العلم في القاهرة بيتي فوق بيته 12 سنة يعني دورين دور أول ودور ثاني أو أنهما قريبان فوق بمعنى بجنب قد تأتي قال فلم أستيقظ في ليلة من الليالي في ساعة من ساعات الليل إلا وجدت ضوء السراج في بيته وهو مشتغل بالعلم وحتى كان في حال الأكل والكتاب والكتب عنده يشتغل فيها حتى وهو يأكل يعني ما الذي يمنعه أن يأكل وهو يقلب صفحات الكتاب ولكن عنده كما قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ما ملأ ابن آدم يعان شرا من بطنه ويأكل فقط الثلث للطعام والثلث للشراب والثلث للنفس بعض الناس يأكل ما شاء الله أكلا كثيرا فإذا ذكرته الثلث قال كلنا أدرى بثلثه يأكل الأخضر واليابس ثم يقول كلنا أدرى بثلثه يعني هذه مغالطة للنفس نعم الله يقول كلوا واشربوا لكن قال بعدها مباشرة إيش ولا تسرفوا فالإسراف مذموم حتى في المباحات لأنه سينقلب إلى ضده وذكرنا قصة الإمام البخاري رحمه الله وكيف كان يقسم ليلته قسم للنوم وقسم للعبادة وقسم للعلم والقسم الذي في للعلم عفوا للنوم يقول كنت أستيقظ في الليلة 20 مرة يعني ممكن لا تسلم له ساعتان أو 3 ساعات ثلث الليل قال وكنت أستيقظ في نومي 20 مرة أشعل السراج وأكتب الفائدة التي تأتيني ثم أطفئه وأنام فلم يكد ينام إلا وتأتيه الفائدة الأخرى فيستيقظ فيوقد السراج فيكتب الفائدة حتى لا تضيع وحتى لا تطير لأن الفوائد إذا جاءت كالصيد الصيد إذا لم تقتنصه هرب وطار وشرد وكذلك الفوائد. ذلك ألف ابن الجوزي كتابا سماه صيد الخاطر. صيد الخاطر يعني شيء يخطر على باله يصيده ويقيده. هكذا أهل العلم، وهكذا استغلالهم للوقت، وهكذا حرصهم على الزمن. والله المستعان.
The Sheikh said, I remembered a story that was mentioned in the biography of one of the scholars of Damascus, the Sheikh Muhammad Jamal al-Din al-Qasim, rahimahullah. He said that he used to pass, walk in the streets of Damascus. He used to pass by the coffee shops, and he would see the people playing with dice. Nard is dice, right? Dice, nard. What is the name of that thing they use? The nard is the two with the numbers, the dice, right? But then there is a game that they play. So he said that by Allah, if the times are like commodities that can be sold and or can be bought, then I will buy the times that all of these people playing dice, I will buy from them their times. So the Sheikh said that these people, they are wasting their time. They are not only wasting their time, but they are wasting the time committing something that is haram. The Sheikh mentioned a hadith that says what means, the one who plays with dice, then it is as if he has immersed his hand in the blood of the pig. The blood of the pig. So these people, they are not only wasting their time, but they are wasting their time and becoming sinful at the same time. Then the Sheikh said, he mentioned what some of the scholars mentioned about one of the imams. He said about him that I lived beside him in the school, that school used to be in Cairo. He said my place is above his place, and I lived beside him for 12 years. So it seems they were living on top of each other, first floor, second floor, like that. He said, I lived beside him in Cairo 12 years. I did not wake up in any one night, in any one time of the night, except that I found that the lamp is lit in his room, and he is busying himself with seeking knowledge. Even at the time of eating, the book or the books were with him, and he was busying himself with that. The Sheikh said that while he's eating, there's nothing to prevent him from like flipping the pages and looking at the books. So this is how that person, that scholar was. So even at the time of eating, he is busy with knowledge. The Sheikh mentioned then the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, which says what means that the son of Adam did not fill up a vessel worse than his stomach. Worse than his stomach. The son of Adam did not fill up a vessel worse than his stomach. If he must do that, then one third for the food, and one third for the drink, and one third for the air. So if someone is eating, then he should give only one third of the stomach for the food that he consumes. But then the Sheikh said that some people will eat a lot and will eat everything, and then when they are told that you need to eat only, fill up only one third for food, then they answer you back saying, Each one of us, we know the size of our third. You know, the third varies from one person to the other. So they know, we know the size of our third. So this is actually just an excuse that they use to not accept this advice. Otherwise, exaggeration is something that is disgraced, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, eat and drink. Eat and drink, and the last part of the ayah says, and la tusrifu, eat and drink, and do not go overboard. Do not go overboard. So going overboard is not praiseworthy, is dispraised, even if it is something that is allowable, something that is halal. The Sheikh said that we mentioned before that an Imam al-Bukhari used to split his night into three parts, a part which, in which he sleeps, and a part which he gets involved in ibadah, worship, and the third part he seeks the knowledge. He seeks the knowledge. And that part which he uses for the sleep, he said about it that he used to wake up during the night about 20 times. About 20 times. He would wake up, then go back to sleep. The Sheikh said if you look at that, then maybe he will only sleep 1 hour or two. He will wake up because he remembered some point of benefit. He will wake up, turn on the light or light up the siraj, the lamp, and he will write down that benefit that came to him, that thought of benefit that came to him. Then he will turn it off and go to sleep. After some time, he will remember or another benefit will happen to him, so he will wake up, turn on the lamp, and then write it down, then turn it off and go back to sleep. And like this, he would do that a lot. So this is because the Sheikh said that those benefits that come to the mind of the scholar, they resemble the prey. If you go hunting, this is the benefit is like a prey that you are trying to hunt. If you don't really catch it and tie it down, then it will be lost. It will be lost. This is why an Imam Ibn al-Jawzi, alayhi rahmatullah, he authored a book that he called The Hunting of Thoughts. The Hunting of Thoughts. So this is how these scholars were so diligent and so careful about utilizing their time.
قال ومن الأمور التي تنبني عليها شخصية المسلم ورع المسلم ووقوفه. الورع هو الخشية من الوقوع في الحرام، وهذا الورع هو الذي يوقفه عند هذه الحدود فلا يتجاوزها ولا يتعداها. وهذا هو الحديث الثاني عشر عن النعمان بن بشير قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إن الحلال بين واضح وصريح، إن الحلال بين والحرام بين، وبينهما مشتبهات لا يعلمهن كثير من الناس. المشتبهات أو المشتبهات هي الأمور غير الواضحة غير البينة. الحلال بين والحرام بين، بينهما كما يقال مسافة أو مساحة غير واضحة الحل أو واضحة الحرمة، لا يعلمهن كثير من الناس. ما الموقف من هذه المساحة التي هي غير بينة الحل وغير بينة الحرمة؟ قال عليه الصلاة والسلام فمن اتقى الشبهات استبرأ لدينه وعرضه. استبرأ أي طلب البراءة. إيش عكس البراءة؟ التهمة والريبة والظن. استبرأ لدينه ولعرضه ولنفسه ولكل ما يقرب منه. ومن وقع في الشبهات وقع في الحرام. من وقع في الشبهات وقع في الحرام، أي كاد يقع في الحرام، كاد يقع في الحرام. كالراعي يرعى حول الحمى، يعني هناك مساحة مزروعة لكن موضوع عليها أشبه ما يكون بالسياج، يعني ليست لك، فجئت بما ترعاه في منطقة قريبة من هذه المنطقة الرعوية المحمية. ها هل تستطيع أن تمنع رعيك من أن يدخل هذا المكان؟ لا تستطيع. لكن إذا ابتعد تستطيع. إذا اقترب توشك أن تدخل إلى هذا الحمى المحمي مما ليس هو لك ولا يجوز لك. قال كالراعي يرعى حول الحمى يوشك أن يرتع فيه، يوشك أن يقع فيه ويحصل فيه الرتع وهو الخوض في الأكل من هذا الشيء المحمي. قال ألا وإن لكل ملك حمى، كل من يملك شيئا له شيء خاص به يحميه عن غيره. ألا وإن حمى الله محارمه، حمى الله محارمه، الشيء الذي منعك الله منه هو محارمه التي حرمها عليك. ألا وإن في الجسد مضغة، المضغة هي القطعة الصغيرة من اللحم. ألا وإن في الجسد مضغة إذا صلحت صلح الجسد كله، وإذا فسدت فسد الجسد كله، ألا وهي القلب. لذلك ذكرنا في درس مضى أن أعمال القلوب هي أساس أعمال الجوارح، وبأعمال القلوب يعرف المؤمن من المنافق. المنافق يصلي صلاتنا ويحج حجنا ويزكي زكاتنا ويقول بقولنا لكنه كافر، بل من أشد الكفار، بل إن المنافقين في الدرك الأسفل من النار. ما الفيصل؟ قلبه، ليس قلبه مؤمنا. بينما المؤمن حتى وإن كان مقصرا خير من المنافق حتى لو كان عاملا، لأن عمل المنافق بغير قلب، بينما عمل المسلم المؤمن المذعن ولو كان يسيرا فإنه ناتج عن قلب مؤمن، فهذا خير من ذاك، وإن كان عمل ذلك الظاهر أكثر من هذا. والحديث رواه البخاري ومسلم.
The Sheikh said that amongst the matters upon which the Muslim personality is based upon is the wara', and the wara' is basically the fear of falling into haram, the fear of falling into haram, and this fear of falling in haram is what makes the Muslim stay at the boundaries. He does not pass those boundaries or limits that Allah has set. And this is the hadith number 12. It is from Al-Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu, who said, I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, surely halal is green, halal is clear and haram is clear. And between them, between both, between the halal and haram, there are doubtful matters that many people do not know about. So the one who avoided and stayed away from the doubtful matters, then he has sought clarity for his religion and for his honor. The Sheikh here said that istabra'a, the word istabra'a, it means to seek to clear yourself, to seek to clear yourself. The opposite of that is being accused or people having evil thoughts about you. So if you stay away from doubtful matters, then you would have sought to clear your deen and to clear your honor from any doubts or from any accusations. As for the one who has fallen into doubtful matters, the one who commits doubtful matters, then he falls into haram, meaning the Sheikh said that he is about to fall into haram. The hadith goes on to say, like the shepherd who brings his flock to roam around the sanctuary. The sanctuary is basically a place where the king will put a limit where no one can bring his animals to eat from the grass there, except for the animals of the king. Nobody can come and roam there, or bring his animals to roam there. So the one who falls into doubtful matters, he resembles the shepherd who brings his sheep closer to the sanctuary. He is about to have his animals go into that sanctuary and start eating from the grass there. If he stayed away with his animals, if he stayed away from the sanctuary, then his animals will not go into that place. But then if he comes close to it, then he cannot control these animals. They will enter inside of that sanctuary. And it is about that these animals will roam around and eat from the grass in that sanctuary. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, surely every king has a sanctuary. Every king has a sanctuary, this fenced area that no one is supposed to go into. And surely the sanctuary of Allah are the things that He has prohibited. The sanctuary of Allah are the things that He has prohibited. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, surely in the body there is a small piece of flesh. There is a morsel, small piece of flesh. If it is good, if that piece of flesh is good, then the whole body will be good. And if it is corrupt, then the whole body will be corrupt. And that is the heart. That small piece of flesh is the heart. The Shaykh said that we mentioned before in an earlier hadith that the actions of the heart are the actions of the hearts are the foundation for the actions of the body parts, and that the heart is the difference. The actions of the heart, they are the difference between the believer and the hypocrite, because the hypocrite does the same actions like the believers, prayer and other than that. But then the hypocrite is a disbeliever. Rather, the hypocrite, as in the Quran, is in the lowest level of the hellfire. So the believer, even if he was deficient, if he was sinful, he is still better than the hypocrite. That is because the heart of the hypocrite is totally corrupt. The Shaykh said that this hadith is narrated by Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim.
قال والمسلم بجنب ما يعرض له في شؤون حياته كلها أمام ثلاثة مواقف. المسلم يعيش حياته، وفي هذه الحياة يتعرض لأشياء، سواء في نفسه، في الآخرين، في عمله، في بيته، لا يكون خارجا عن هذه الثلاث، عن هذه الحياة كلها شيء على هذه الأشياء الثلاث. أولا الامتناع المطلق، وذلك للحرام الواضح الصريح الذي عبر عنه الحديث النبوي بقوله الحلال بين، عفوا الحرام بين. الأخذ المطلق وهو الشيء الثاني، وذلك للحلال الجلي الظاهر، وهو الذي عبر عنه الحديث بقوله الحلال بين. الشيء الثالث التوقف، وذلك لما لم تظهر صورته أحلال أم حرام. عندنا شيء غير ظاهر، حلال أو حرام، أيهما أولى؟ نقدم أم نحجم؟ نقبل أم نتوقف؟ هو غير ظاهر، لا شك ولا ريب أن التوقف هو الأصل. لذلك جاء عن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قوله دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك. ما يريبك أي ما يوضع، ما يجعل الشك والريبة في قلبك، إلى ما لا يريبك، إلى ما لا سبب فيه لهذه الريبة. وورد في بعض الروايات لكن لا يصح إسنادها، وإن كان معناها صحيحا، لا يبلغ العبد درجة المتقين حتى يدع ما ليس به بأس حذرا مما به بأس. هذا يروى حديثا ولا يصح، لكنه من حيث المعنى معنى صحيح. قالوا هذا الأخير وهو التوقف إن دل فإنما يدل على ورع المسلم وخوفه من مواقعة الحرام ومداخلة المنكر، لأن هذا الشيء الذي لا يعرفه احتمال أن يكون حراما، فكيف يدخله؟ أن يتوقاه وأن يحذر منه خير له من أن يقدم عليه وأن يهجم إليه. قال فهو يقف عنده ويبتعد عنه إرضاء لله وامتثالا لأمره، ولا يقول كما يقول البعض هذا ليس حراما فافعله. هذا خطأ، هذا خطأ وخطأ قبيح. وهذا يذكرني بشيء يعني من أجوبة عامة الناس، تقول لهم الدخان حرام، يقول لك إذا كان حرام فنحن نحرقه. هذه فلسفة ومغالطة للنفس بالباطل. الحرام تجتنبه، ما لم يظهر لك حكمه تجتنب عنه وتبتعد منه وتحرص على المحاذرة. فهذا كما يقول البعض هذا ليس حراما ففعله، لا، فليس كل ما هو غير حرام يجوز فعله، فما كان من الشبهات فهو إلى الحرام أقرب، كما في الحديث نفسه: ومن وقع في الشبهات وقع في الحرام، من وقع في الشبهات وقع في الحرام. ثم لنسمع قول النبي الكريم صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين: البر ما اطمأنت إليه النفس، والإثم ما حاك في الصدر، وكرهت أن يطلع عليه الناس. هذا ميزان يزن به المؤمن الحق هذه المسائل حتى يحذر ويبتعد مما اشتبه عليه مما قد يكون مخالفا لأمر الله تعالى. قال: وهذا الخوف والورع مما يثبت أن المسلم صادق في شؤونه كلها. وهذا هو الحديث 13 وموضع الكلام عنه وشرحه في الدرس القادم إن شاء الله. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.
The Sheikh said that the Muslim, in what he goes through in his daily life, he is in front of, or he is facing three positions. He is facing three positions. The first one, either completely withholding himself, and that is in matters where there is haram. There is haram, and it is clear, manifest haram. So the Muslim would completely withhold himself from doing it. Secondly, to take or to do completely, and that is for the halal, that is clear and apparent halal. So his position from that is to take it without restrictions. As for the third position, and that is the position of basically pausing and withholding oneself, not getting involved in it. And that is for matters which are not clear whether they are halal or they are haram. So here, when we are faced with something like this, then we pause and we need to think, should we go on, should we embark on it, or we should refrain and withhold ourselves from getting involved in it. If it is a matter that is doubtful, if it is a matter that is doubtful, we are not sure if it's halal or haram, then to avoid it and to stay away from it is what should be done. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says what means, leave that which makes you doubt to that which does not make you doubt. And also it has been narrated, but then it is not an authentic hadith. The chain of it is not authentic, but the meaning of it is correct. It is narrated as a hadith, but it's not an authentic hadith, but the meaning of it is correct. It says that the servant of Allah will not reach the level of the pious ones, muttaqin, except when he leaves things that there is no harm in them, for the fear that he will fall in things that are harmful to him. So once again, the Sheikh said that the meaning here is correct, but then it is not an authentic hadith. So this last thing, the third position, which is to pause and not to go on, that is in cases when you are faced with something that is doubtful. This, the Sheikh said, if it proves anything, then it proves that the Muslim has wara. He is afraid of the things that will make him fall into haram and being involved in something that is evil. So he stops there and stays away from it out of seeking to please Allah Azza wa Jal and to carry out his orders. Unlike what some people say, they say, this is not haram, so do it. The Sheikh said, no, that is a mistake, and this is a horrible mistake. Because not everything that is not haram, then it is allowed to be done. Matters that are doubtful, then it is closer to that which is haram. As in this hadith itself, it says, the one who falls into doubtful matters, then he will fall into haram. The Sheikh said here that some people, the common folks, when they are advised regarding smoking cigarettes, they are told that smoking cigarettes is haram. So they say, if it is haram, then here we are burning it. Here we are burning it. So this shows that they don't accept, and they are making a statement like this. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that righteousness is what your soul finds peace and tranquility with it. Righteousness is what your soul finds peace and tranquility in it. While sinning or being sinful is that which moves in your chest, and you hate that the people will know about you, that you have done it. So this hadith is also a scale for you to weigh things. If you are faced with something that is confusing to you, then you use this. If it is something that you feel nothing wrong about it in your heart, then it is a righteous thing. But if you feel that there is something wrong with it and continues to move inside of your chest, and you hate for the people to know that you have done something like it, then that thing is something that you should stay away from. And this fear or wara, this fear and wara proves that the Muslim is truthful in all of his affairs. And this is the subject of the hadith number 13, which we will do in the next session, inshallah.